The search for science had been the quest for comfort and mercy in the face of an arbitrary deity. And communism was seen as scientific. And for those more in love with science than with faith in God, for that reason the idea of communism had been especially appealing. If science was morality, then it was the duty of all good men to pursue it. And the love of everything good had always been carried in the heart of the King of France. And the French had a saying, "To understand is to forgive, because to understand God is to love God." The Norwegians had a saying, "Tell me and I'll know, show me and I'll remember, let me do it myself and I'll understand." And Louis XVI's mother had been born in Dresden to an Austrian mother married to the King of Poland. And Louis XVI would marry Marie Antoinette, whose mother was Maria Theresa of Austria. When the revolutionaries in France killed Louis XVI in January of 1793, they took away Marie Antoinette's 7-year-old son, Louis Charles, who would die as a prisoner at age 10, with his body covered in scars, and his heart was smuggled away during the autopsy to be kept as a Catholic relic. Marie Antoinette had been killed 9 months after they killed her husband, Louis XVI, and Pharamond had been the first king of France in the year 420, and Clovis after him had been the first king of France to become a Christian. Clovis had been born at Tournai, in the year 466, and he'd gone to live in the holy city of Cologne on the Rhine, where the three magi were buried. And in 1935, it wasn't science that was evil in Germany, but what people were doing with it. The medical experiments being performed by Nazi doctors were not scientific, such as injecting bleach into brown eyes to make them a lighter color, or freezing people to see how long downed pilots could survive in the North Sea. And while science was taking a step backwards during Hitler's war, George Orwell was writing Animal Farm that would first be published in 1946. And in case anyone missed the point of the story in Animal Farm, George Orwell bestowed the name of Napoleon upon the barnyard's pig leader, who was more equal than others. More equal than the others. C.M. Woodhouse wrote an introduction in the Signet paperback edition of the New American Library in 1956 from Harcourt, Brace & Company, Inc., where Woodhouse said that the only morality in Animal Farm was, "Don't take to drink and let your animals get out of hand." George Orwell had written Animal Farm as a warning to the English when they were preparing to cast ballots after Hitler's war, and when the voters failed to get the message, he wrote 1984 in 1948. George Orwell had been born in India, where his father worked in the opium department of the Indian Civil Service, and his mother had been born in Burma, where her French father had been involved in, quote, "speculative ventures," close quote. America and England were two brothers born of a common language, and the second would rule the firstborn. And the British had been crippled by their resentment towards Russia for having withdrawn from the first coalition to stop Napoleon in 1792, making it that much harder to defeat the revolutionary French. According to the Big Book, resentment is the number one offender, and Napoleon had been forced to become an emperor in the face of the stiff British resistance. And he became an emperor so that the European nobility would accept him as their legitimate neighbor. Thereafter, the British crown encouraged the Church of England to peg Russia as the land of Gog and Magog rather than its being Turkey, while the sale of the best Turkish opium on the planet kept the Ottoman Muslims firmly in control of the Holy Land, despite the best bargaining the British had to offer. A presence of drugs or alcohol was a medical matter, and while withdrawal preferably would be done under medical supervision, it could also be done for them without their consent, but that sort of recovery risked being only a temporary condition, and ultimately, it would be realized that the patient must take charge of their own health. The disease concept that alcoholic addicts were sick called for imposed quarantine if they didn't know enough to quarantine themselves. And the fun part about the whole thing is trying to explain the disease to them when they don't even know they're sick, because in the attempt, the rest of us are kept in touch with what it means to be truly healthy. Addiction is also a quote-unquote family matter. As important as it is to help the patient, educating, supporting, and counseling relatives may be the therapist's most valuable and enduring contribution. It's also a quote-unquote family matter in another sense. Healthcare professionals are at high risk for addiction, and they and their relatives are also, quote, our family. Essential Psychopathology, page 140. In order to avoid any discussion of the 12 steps, a search for the science of sobriety began after Hitler's war, but the harder they looked, the farther away a solution seemed to be, until many just simply held their nose and tried it the AA way, and thus they grew. In Betty Ford's book, she said that she'd been sent to the Long Beach Naval Shipyard for the Navy's drug and alcohol rehabilitation program started in a Quonset hut in 1965, and the program was undercover because the Navy refused to admit that alcoholism was a problem until 1974, and that was when they moved the program into the Long Beach Naval Hospital. An alcoholic was simply someone who needed to drink because they'd gotten used to it. Several longtime members of Mao's staff, Wang reported, had ignored the suffering of the masses and became a privileged elite. The whole nation was suffering, Wang said, and these staff members threw lavish banquets, eating and drinking extravagantly without paying, using their privileges to buy fancy consumer goods not available in ordinary markets. They were giving everyone in Group 1 a bad name. Private Life of Chairman Mao, page 342. Herderlin. Oh, offer me the fragrant goblet filled with the dusky light, that I may rest in peace, ah, sweet, to sleep among shadows. Reminiscence translated by Michael Hamburger. But someone reach me a fragrant cupful of dark light, that I may rest, it would be sweet, to drowse in the shade. Remembrance translated by Richard Sieberth. Hanna said, quote, to thinking belongs composure and serenity, Galatianheit, close quote. Yet Heidegger knew truth was more like internal lightning that only strikes but a few times per forest, with the proximity of near misses thrilling enough to compel one to stand watching in fervent hope of seeing more, yet willingly content to live with the mere memory of those first seen blinding flashes. Herderlin. Should God appear to you on a burning path under pines, or in the dark of oaks sheathed in steel, or among clouds, you would recognize him, knowing in your youth the power of good, and the Lord's smile never escapes you. By day, when life appears fevered and chained, or by night, when everything blends into confusion and primeval, chaos reigns once more. Herderlin Hymns, translated by Sieberth, page 81. Heidegger would die in the spring of 1976 at the age of 86, and Hanna had died the previous December. And as Hitler's war had been spreading out over old Europe, the peace of AA was spreading across America. After Hitler's war, the EU fell into the dangerous error of which Heidegger had warned by deciding that Germans were guilty of intentionally murdering Jews, and to punish Germany, or perhaps to distract from their own complicity in the Holocaust, the EU paid radical Islamic terrorists to infiltrate unchecked into the fatherland. And 70 years later, it would take 20 lawyers, 40 FBI agents, 500 search warrants, 2,800 subpoenas, and $42 million to find out that Americans had elected Donald Trump so that America could be friends with Russia, in large part because President Putin knew how to deal with Islamists. In 1935, the anti-God commies in Germany had been opposed to individual rights, and when Hitler's socialism veered away from the strength of the individual towards a preference for the collective, they had begun to fail, and the end of the Reich had come sooner rather than later. beginning in November of 1944. Sightings of UFOs over battlefields were thought by both sides to be secret weapons. And in 1947, a flying disc crashed in Roswell, New Mexico, to put the fear of God into all non-believers. Kenneth Arnold described a flying saucer sighting in 1948 in Fate magazine, and the Summer of the Saucers in 1952 resulted in Project Blue Book, and Benny and Barney Hill made alien abduction a popular thing in 1961. A movie about extraterrestrials would be made called The Arrival that starred Charlie Sheen and began with a close-up of a poppy. And the year after that, the movie Contact, starring Jodie Foster, began with the SETI people discovering a signal coming from deep outer space. And when they put it onto a big television screen and fussed with the picture, it started to look like something resembling a swastika. So they tinkered with the resolution some more and found out it certainly was a swastika, that the aliens were sending back an old broadcast of Hitler opening the Olympic Games in 1936, because that had been the first TV broadcast powerful enough to go out into space, and sending it back had been their way of saying hello. A German named Bill Herschel, 1738-1822, had discovered the planet Uranus, and sometimes he'd looked through his telescope for so long that his feet would freeze to the ground. And Isaac Newton had been elected to the Royal Society in 1672 as the result of his work on telescopes, since space was the final frontier, and by then the entire planet Earth had been mapped by thoroughly competent scientists. A hugely popular abduction book would be written by Whitley Strieber in 1987 called Communion, A True Story, wherein Whitley described seeing a little man sitting in the woods behind his house smoking cigarettes. So Whitley went over to warn him about the danger of fire, and the little guy had growled at him that sounded like an animal. Whitley went back the next day to find hundreds of cigarette butts and a little shelter made of woven branches so intricate and unworldly that Whitley went to go get a camera, but he could never find the place again. And Whitley didn't tell the story for years because he knew how unbelievable it was. Another alien abduction story was that of a man taken into a UFO, and the aliens asked him what had happened to the British. Suddenly the abductee was filled with vast knowledge of British history and began telling the aliens all about Britain, talking on and on for hours, until the aliens interrupted him to say they simply wanted to know why the British had failed. When H.G. Wells' book about an alien invasion at Grover's Mills was read over the radio on Halloween in 1938, the War of the Worlds broadcast was believed to be real by people tuning in during the middle of the show, and because hundreds of people panicked, that reaction set government policy in stone that no information about UFOs would thereafter be released to the public, lest there be panic and disarray endangering the population. H.G. Wells' book The War of the Worlds had been written in 1897, and when the movie came out in 1953, it had been preceded 2 years earlier by a movie called The Thing from Another World that was made in 1951, and The Thing was about a hostile alien getting loose after scientists thawed a crashed saucer frozen in the Antarctic ice. The popularity of that movie about The Thing spawned the Summer of Saucers in 1952. And the movie had showcased a mad scientist who could not be trusted. And the following year, the movie of The War of the Worlds came out due to public demand for more entertainment involving UFOs. The movie about The Thing was based on a book written in the summer of 1938 by John W. Campbell. And he'd called his science fiction stories space operas. And the theme of The Thing was that people would become infected with a horrible otherworldly disease that changed their personalities and absorbed their memories and caused them to murder people. And those who had been infected were impossible to detect apart from a blood test, and they themselves did not know whether they had acquired the disease. After becoming infected with the alien horror, The only cure was to burn the victims to ashes, and the original title of Campbell's book had been Who Goes There? One intriguing theory about UFOs was that they were just God's garbage men. Although to History Anonymous, it can be certain that they know exactly where the lost crystal is, but so far they aren't telling. The son of the Dr. Sadlers would die the same day that JFK was assassinated, and his own namesake son had died 2 months after the Urantia book was published in 1955, and he had died at the age of 19 after he'd been taking barbiturates. The senior Dr. Sandler would live until the 26th of April in 1969, when he would die at the age of 93, and his wife Lena had died at the age of 64 in August of 1939, 1 month before Hitler's war broke out. According to the Urantia book, when the Garden of Eden had fallen apart, the loyal Van and his followers had built a ship and sailed around the world looking for anyone else who had escaped the garden unharmed. And they'd reached Holland before they gave up and began building windmills out of their sails, and they built dams to stand upon so they could throw rocks at any savages who might want to land. Because the people in Holland were descended from the loyal Van, they put his name into their own, such as Van Buren and Van Nuys and Van Gogh. And the handy thing about dams was that if pirates managed to get ashore, the Dutch could open the floodgates and drown them like rats. The Dutch dams not only held back the sea, but were great places from which to launch ships. And the Dutch were honest, fair, straightforward tradesmen. And when they reached North America after sailing away from Holland to escape the English king trying to also become the king of France, the Dutch in America started a market where people could come to do their business. Manhattan Island had been especially attractive because there were two escape routes from which they could flee from marauding British pirates, but this would also be their doom when the British sailed through both places at once to turn New Amsterdam into New York. The name Amsterdam had the same word stir that had come from their answer, I am from the stars and now build here. And the man who wrote Star Trek in 1964 had read the Urantia book, and he had wanted to call Star Trek Wagon Train to the Stars. In English, Captain Kirk would have been Captain Church. And the first time the word hell was spoken on television was in April of 1967 when Captain Kirk said, let's get the hell out of here. At Fatima, the sun had staggered in the sky and then stumbled towards the earth. And when the sun plunged downwards, people who had been wet had suddenly become dry. To be spaced out or on another planet was to be drunk or under the influence of drugs. And because we'd been made in God's image, there's always the possibility that the Roswell crash had been a drunk driving accident. The Greek word for baptism meant to sink or to disable or to overwhelm, and specifically to be overwhelmed by, quote, going under, close quote. And the concept of baptism easily fit into the definition of being in a state of drunkenness as one immersed oneself in the living water that would make us thirst no more. While a drunk had gotten in over his head, after being sufficiently submerged, he would come out a changed man, one who personally and comfortably knew and had entered into a relationship with the Lord. During baptism, the heavens were opened, and the power of God came down upon us. And theologically, we were elevated from one state to another through baptism. And to perform the Jewish tradition of tevila, or baptismo, required 120 gallons, or just as much water as was deep enough to completely plunge into. The Northwest Indians had thought that only slaves drank too much, and when they began drinking themselves, they came to the conclusion that they were also slaves. Many African slaves took upon themselves the name of their owners out of love for them, and the Indian Sacagawea had also been a slave. It required hero stuff to build our North Coast Empire, and upon an immortal fore will ever rest that glory. Thomas Jefferson, the nation builder, Meriwether Lewis and William Clark, the empire hunters, and the red-skinned girl Sacagawea, who led them to their conquest. In all the annals of history, there is no story to surpass that of the Indian bird woman, who more than once saved the heart of that great enterprise from swift decay, and even denied her own papoose the long-saved crust, crusts that the strength of our color-bearers might not fade. With outstretched arm, she led a hostile race that they might build great cities over the graves of her kind. But for her, the turrets and towers that rose along the trail might today fly the bunting of a foreign flag. She was the silent, faithful, untiring pathfinder who led the Stars and Stripes up Missouri's waters, over the great rocky divide, and down the Sunset River to the great Father of Seas, that white children might one day sing the song she herself had loved before its words were framed, "My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty." She, like Columbus, believed that, quote, "one day with life and heart is more than time enough to find a world," close quote. In the hearts of Jefferson's brave explorers, she kept that spirit aflame, and so we celebrate. The World's Great Events, Volume 8, New York, P.F. Collier and Son Corporation, 1908, 1945, page 145 and 6. Jefferson kept slaves that afforded him the time and money to read plenty of books, that fed his belief in humanism rather than believing in divinely appointed rulers, and in materialism rather than the spiritualist notion of accepting poverty as a virtue. And above all, Jefferson read about the noble nature of the common man as having been bestowed by the Creator directly and inalienably. Jefferson used such phrases as natural laws and utilitarian usefulness that were understood to be scientific concepts. And while Jefferson thought that religious differences should be tolerated, he stated, quote, "but our rulers can have no authority over such natural rights, only as we have submitted to them. The rights of conscience we never submitted, we could not submit. We are answerable for them to our God," close quote. "The legitimate powers of government extend to such acts only as are injurious to others, but it does me no injury for my neighbor to say there are 20 gods or no god. It neither picks my pocket nor breaks my leg." Thomas Jefferson by Stuart Jerry Brown, New York, Washington Square Press, The Great American Thinkers Series, Notes on Virginia, 1966, page 215. Jefferson also had the time and money to make and to entertain plenty of friends, and these founding fathers promoted science by sending Lewis and Clark and other expeditions out west on scientific journeys of exploration. And Americans hoped the Indians would stop fighting now that the English were not around anymore to stir them up against the French. The French Revolution hadn't been so much about getting rid of God as it had been a great hope that in abolishing the throne of the King of France, perhaps the English across the Channel would stop wanting to come over to claim the title of King of France for themselves. The guillotine had been a terror to French Catholics, who thought it important to be buried unmutilated, believing that God would only resurrect them into the next life if their bodies had gone properly into the grave. The faithful European nobility had rejoiced at the final defeat of Napoleon in 1814 because it had been 1,000 years since the Holy Roman Emperor Charlemagne had died in 814, and they saw the restoration of the divinely appointed nobility in Europe at the Congress of Vienna in 1814 as being a very big deal indeed. Many had believed that Napoleon was the Antichrist, knocking God's anointed off their thrones, and restoring the nobility at the Congress of Vienna heralded the new kingdom of God in Europe. And because Europe encompassed all of the civilized world, the Congress of Vienna had resurrected the legitimate rule of God's kingdom on earth. Prussia received the Rhineland in 1814, and the Kingdom of Hanover was born, and exactly 100 years later, the Great War would break out, and it would be called the War to Make the World Safe for Democracy. Charlemagne hadn't been a very important king, and he didn't even rule very long, but he was responsible for having grapevines planted in the Rhine Valley, and when he died, Charlemagne had given the middle part to Louis, quote, "in order that he might have wine in his kingdom," close quote. Rhineland, Wineland by S.F. Hallgarten, London Arlington Books, 1951, 1965, page 21. When visiting Germany, you may come across some giant casks, and the best known of all is the giant cask of Heidelberg. Many authors mention these giant casks as a sign of how much wine was drunk in the Middle Ages, but they forget to mention where they were found, mostly in fortresses, where they served to store as much wine as possible in as small a space as possible as provisions in case of war. Rhineland, Wineland, page 22. Inside the women's apartments in the Heidelberg castle, there is a pump that can draw wine up from the great cask. The pump was built in 1751. The cask could hold 220,000 liters. It was only filled 3 times before it started leaking. In the 16th century, monks in Bavaria had been brewing beer to drink during the fasting season of Lent. And they began to worry that it might be sinful to have so much fun drinking their Lenten beer, so the good monks took a barrel of it to the Pope in Rome, and they gave some to the cardinals for sampling. The cardinals thought the beer was horrible stuff, since they were wine drinkers, and the Pope told the Bavarian monks to keep drinking their beer to atone for their sins by having to suffer its terrible taste. At the beginning of the 15th century, the Hussite nobility had joined together to protect on their lands their own interpretation of the gospel, and they replaced their priests with ones who would give out communion using wine in addition to the bread, and the chalice of wine became the central identifying symbol of the Hussite movement. When Puritans in 1620 during the Thirty Years' War sailed from Holland bound for America on the Mayflower, the drink of choice in Bermuda was palmetto wine, and in 1627 a law was passed to prevent the complete destruction of palmetto trees on Bermuda used in making palm alcohol. The Berlin Opera sold beer in 1913, and the Kaiser imposed a dress code of ausgeschnitten gowns for women and suits for men, and the dress code was to keep away those who brought their own bread and meat into the opera house to consume along with their beer. Maria Theresa had thought the Silesians were Austrians rather than Germanics, because they preferred wine to beer, and because Austria had not helped their French friends in the Franco-Prussian War of 1871, Bismarck had rewarded Austria by allowing them to move back into their lovely port of Trieste. Austria was also given Bosnia and Herzegovina, wherein the Moslems had made themselves comfortable. And even though both the Russians and the Austrian Habsburgs had been at war with the Ottoman Muslims for a very long time, Austria had been making friends with the Muslim Turks in hopes of gaining some leverage over keeping Britain out of Turkey. The Ottomans had brutally suppressed the Bulgarian uprising of 1876, and the Moslems had massacred almost 100,000 people, and that prompted Europe to step in with the Conference of Constantinople in January of 1877, the upshot of which was that Europe was unable to convince Disraeli that Russia's offer to keep the Moslems in Serbia at bay was not a Russian trick to take over Constantinople. Disraeli was insisting that the British would go to any lengths to protect their sea lanes to India, even if it meant aligning themselves with the Moslems, and because of Disraeli's obstinance, the task of protecting Christians in Serbia had fallen to Austria rather than to Russia. The British had agreed because they cut some kind of a deal with the Moslem Turks, yet unknown to History Anonymous, and the Russians launched the Russo-Turkish War right away after the Conference of Constantinople, and it took the Russians 10 months to win that war, which handed Serbia and Romania and Montenegro their freedom from Islamic rule. Because the Conference of Constantinople gave Bosnia-Herzegovina to Austria, Britain was given Cyprus, and from Cyprus, Britain sent troops into Egypt in 1882 under the pretext of helping the Ottoman government put down the Urabi revolt, and that would leave Egypt ostensibly as a British colony until 1952. The Ottomans had conquered Egypt in 1517, and under their rule the Egyptians had suffered a half dozen severe famines and 100 smaller ones, and Egypt had lost to starvation 17% of its population in 1784, after which the British came and planted cotton in 1820, after Napoleon had finally been defeated. The atrocities committed by Muslims trying to move up through the Balkans into Europe had reached such levels of horror by 1862 that all of Europe told the Muslim Turks to back out of Serbia, so they did. By 1876, the Serbians had gotten strong enough to declare war on the Ottoman Muslims, while the Christians in Bulgaria and in Bosnia-Herzegovina were also rising up against the Muslim Turks. And with the Conference of Constantinople, Austria was given the opportunity to help Serbia keep the Muslims restrained, but instead, the Serbian king and queen were helping the Austrians to persecute Orthodox Russians. The patriarch of the Armenian Apostolic Church was named Crimean, and he went to the Conference of Constantinople in January of 1877 to seek advice about keeping the Muslim Turks out of Armenia. And when he found no help there, Patriarch Crimean turned to Russia, who commenced the Russo-Turkish War in April of 1877 in partnership with the Bulgarians. Just as they reached Constantinople, the British sent battleships and insisted that Russia accept the Turkish offer of surrender and send Russian emissaries to the Congress of Berlin to sign revised terms in the summer of 1878. In Berlin, Macedonia was given back to the Ottoman Muslims, and Russian gains were severely curtailed, leaving them unable to help the Armenians unless the Tsar wanted war with Britain, who had been mobilizing the previous fall in 1877 under Disraeli to fight Russia so the British could save Constantinople for their friends the Muslim Turks, who had appealed to Disraeli for help. The Armenian Apostolic Church was in the town of Van on the shore of Lake Van, and it was the oldest Christian church in the world. And from 1894 to 1896, between 100,000 and 300,000 Armenians were murdered by Islamic Turks because the Armenians had been reaching out to Russia for protection. It had been easy to get the Muslims to slaughter the Armenians because the Christians in Turkey had a higher standard of living due to their better schools and superior culture, while the Muslim schools taught only the Quran, which was written in the difficult Arabic language, and study of the Quran had a heavy emphasis on memorization. Greeks were still the majority of businessmen in the Turkish world, and the rest of Europe failed to help the Armenians, many of whom fled to Russia. The Serbian military also wanted to ally with Russia rather than with the Austrians, who were trying to make deals with the Ottomans in order to put through the Berlin to Baghdad railroad so they could ship Turkish opium up into Europe without having to sail up the Adriatic Sea from the Mediterranean, where they would inevitably encounter the British Royal Navy. The Austrians wanted to prop up the Ottoman Turks for that reason, and construction of the railroad was awarded to an Ottoman company in 1903, but the Russians warned the Austrians that doing business with Muslims was not a good idea. When mercenaries were dispatched to murder the Serbian royal family 2 years later, the question History Anonymous must have asked was, who would benefit from stopping the Berlin to Baghdad railroad going through Belgrade? The king and queen of Serbia had become friendly with Austria in 1903 because they had all envisioned the riches that would accrue from the opium trade into Europe via the railroad through the Balkans. And in June of 1903, a couple dozen armed men gathered at several drinking establishments around town, and in the middle of the night they went to the Serbian palace and cut the electricity and dynamited the royal bedroom door and murdered the royal family, and they also killed a handful of the royal family's friends. The Austrians could have cut Russia into the railroad deal by simply giving them Serbia and then paid reasonable tariffs or transfer fees to Russia, which would have avoided the Great War, and History Anonymous has yet to solve the mystery of why that didn't happen. Some historians said that the Austrian military killed Franz Ferdinand in 1914 to get a war going so that the Roman Catholic Austrians could get rid of the Russian Orthodox Serbs in Serbia, but the religious angle was just a vain attempt in the aftermath to explain how the Great War had gotten started. According to that theory, instead of joining forces with Russia against the Islamists, the Austrians asked the German Kaiser if they could get away with a quick war in 1914 to expel the Russian Orthodox Serbs from Serbia. And the Kaiser had assured Austria that Russia would never go to war over Serbia, but he was wrong. The Kaiser had given Austria his promise that Germany would support the Austrians in their Serbian adventure, since the Kaiser needed that railroad going through to Germany from the Turkish opium fields, and he had no idea how lucrative that venture could become, with more than plenty of profit affording a pittance to the Russians in Serbia for transit over their tracks. So for lack of knowledge about the poppy business, the Kaiser thought it expedient to stand up to the Tsar. The Austrian military was overly prepared for some hot battlefield exercises after having warmed up during the Balkan Wars. And the Ottoman Muslims had lost the Balkan Wars in October 1912 to May 1913, and losing their Islamic control in the Balkans had stoked their hatred towards Christians, which would bring on the genocide of over 1.5 million more Armenians starting in 1914, which they committed against the Armenians under cover of the Great War so they could pretend it had been a military exercise. The Ottoman Muslims had been defeated in the Balkan Wars because the Europeans were finally working together to defeat them. And around 400,000 Muslims had fled from the Balkans into Turkey, where many of them died in a cholera epidemic. By 1914, the Muslims had been driven out of nearly all of Europe and North Africa, although they still controlled 28 million people, half of them in Turkey and the rest in Greater Arabia. The expulsion of the Turkish Muslims from the Balkans resulted in Greece, Serbia, Romania, and Bulgaria entering the vacuum to fight over their own borders in the Second Balkan War during the summer of 1913. But the main sticking point making the Great War inevitable had been the creation of Albania in the Treaty of London after the First Balkan War, because after all the sacrifice given by Serbia, the Serbs were cut off from the sea by the formation of a new country called Albania that was 50 miles wide and 200 miles long and should have belonged to Serbia. And for that swindle, the Serbs were blaming Austria. The Ottomans sided with the Austrians in the Great War in hopes of getting some of their previous conquests back. And when they lost in 1918, the Sultan lost his caliphate on the 1st of November in 1922, and the last Sultan left Turkey on the 17th of November. The Grand National Assembly was declared the Republic of Turkey on the 29th of October in 1923, and the Caliphate was outlawed on the 3rd of March in 1924, and the Ottoman Empire died with a fizzle rather than with a bang. The Serbian military's primary goal had been to keep out the Muslim Turks, and the Austrians' primary goal had been to put that railroad through from Constantinople to Belgrade to Berlin, even if they had to make a deal with the devil to get it done. And while Russia was willing to help the Serbian military deal with the Muslims, the Austrians had been laser-focused on that railroad. In 1914, the Austrians were still accusing the Black Hand of breaking into the Royal Serbian Palace and murdering the king and queen in 1903. And Austria sent a 10-point ultimatum to Serbia, and one of the points was that Austrian and Hungarian police were to be allowed to come into Serbia so they could wipe out the Black Hand, which would be like the UN coming into America to wipe out the Hell's Angels. Not a good idea. The Austrians had been accusing the Black Hand of murdering the king and queen to cover up their own complicity in the massacre, and Serbians had been preparing for war in 1914 because they'd had nothing to do with the assassination of Franz Ferdinand either. Franz Ferdinand had not wanted war at all, but had planned to turn the Balkan region into separate provinces modeled after the United States. And the Austrian military didn't like that idea at all, and they also didn't want any Serb participation in the government. The Austrians wanted to run their part of the Great War themselves without having to answer to Germany about anything, because it was supposed to be just a short local war in Serbia, and they thought that Russia would stay out due to the threat of Germany coming in. Germany had asked Russia to stop mobilizing several times because all the Germans were out on harvest leave so the crops could be brought in as the summer wound down. But thanks to the railroads, the speed of Russian mobilization would seal Germany's fate, even though the Germans would begin to win on the Eastern Front. But the Schlieffen Plan had bogged down in the West from the very beginning. As soon as the war began, Austria had been asked to hold off the Russians temporarily so Germany could invade Belgium and France, and the fight on the Western Front would keep the French from helping Russia, and the Austrians facing Russia lost its entire professional army in the first 5 months, over 1 million men. The two generals leading the Austrian army had argued, one wanting to invade Bosnia before turning around to fight Russia, and the train schedules had gotten screwed up. And as the trench warfare dug in and no amount of countermeasures could break the murderous stalemate, halfway through the Great War, Germany allowed Lenin's train to pass through the fatherland into Russia. And the idea was that some revolutionist disruption would help the German soldiers who were in the trenches facing Russia. Bringing down Russia would give the British some excuse to negotiate with the Kaiser, and Disraeli and his successors had cultivated extensive contacts with anti-Russian agitators all over the world because Disraeli had not been able to see past his fear that Russia wanted to unite all the Orthodox Christians so Mother Russia could protect them from the Islamic terrorists, and Disraeli had seen Russia's actions as merely being a threat to Jews. The ancient Jews and the Muslims had once been one group who would circle the black stone together in the desert 7 times. Later, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, "This is what the Lord God of Israel says. Let my people go into the desert to celebrate a festival in my honor." Exodus 5:1, God's Word Translation. "Say to him, 'The Lord God of the Hebrews sent me to tell you, let my people go to worship me in the desert. So far you have not listened.'" Exodus 7:16, Ibid. After God told the chosen people to stop worshiping the black stone in the desert, the Arabs in Mecca continued to do the circling routine until Muhammad was born in the year of the elephant, and Muhammad started a new religion after the devil appeared to Muhammad when he was sitting in his cave, and it would take until after the Japanese surrender in 1945 to come up with a solution to the problem of Islam with the Shinto plan. The devil had told Muhammad that the Ummah was above the individual, and Al-Anon means Allah not, or no Allah, and E Pluribus Unum means that the many are one too. If being drunk or on drugs is medically and materially equivalent to being insane, then the person under the influence has relinquished their ability to engage in contracts. You should not have gloated over the misfortune of your relatives in Judah. You should not have been glad on the day of their ruin. You should not have laughed at them in their distress. Obadiah 1:12, Good News Translation. Bill Sadler wrote Prescription for Permanent Peace in 1944, and he said that we should treat nations as though they were sick too, which was why in 1935 he had attracted a special place in God's eye for getting the Urantia book out into the world. If the Holocaust happened again, we would have the choice of wearing a triangle and a circle or taking a drink, and the growth of AA after Hitler's war was helped along by the general abhorrence of anyone being sent away for special treatment, or being branded as medically unfit, or encouraging children to rat out their parents, or the authorities requiring parents to turn their children over for indoctrination. After the failure of Nazism, there was no appetite for allowing the state to usurp jurisdiction over facing alcoholism, and the churches were in no position to put themselves forward as moral authorities because they were being blamed for the Holocaust. So the question of alcoholism had been left in private hands after Hitler's war, specifically in the hands of the family, who were more often than not a substantial part of the problem. Elizabeth I's mother, Anne Boleyn, had been a poppy juice drinker, which explained the large, mysterious eyes that had fascinated Henry VIII enough to kick the Catholic Church out of England so he could start his own religion. And 100 years after Henry VIII met with the King of France at the Cloth of Gold near Calais on the 7th of June in 1520, his successor, King James VI, hated the Puritans so much and gave them such a bad time that they willingly climbed on board the Mayflower for the arduous journey over the Atlantic to the New World. When Bill W. called Dr. Bob from the Mayflower Hotel in Akron, Ohio in 1935, people in America had been accusing the Oxford groups of being anti-Christian because the good people of America thought the only solution to our troubles was the second coming of Jesus in the flesh, and who could argue with that? A Nazi report written in November of 1936, marked secret, said that Frank Buchmann was a dangerous opponent to National Socialism because the groups were too Christian, which meant that they were tainted with Judaism and thus were hung up on guilt and atonement. The Nazi report complained that the Oxforders were attracting women to the movement, while in Germany women were supposed to be staying home raising children instead of attending the meetings and visiting the homes of strangers for house parties. The ancient German folk stories had not been about superheroes, but were tales of confused, wounded warriors. And the point of the story was always that love and truth could only be found after becoming lost and having suffered wounds. Al Gore said that there were 6 years of crop failure before the 1789 French Revolution, and that May had been the coldest on record, so the wine harvest had failed completely that year. And in 1815, a volcano in Indonesia erupted and lowered the temperature of the planet a full degree. And some scientists claimed that a drop of only 1.5 degrees of temperature long term would bring about another ice age. It had taken only 12 days for the tropospheric winds to disperse the volcano's ashes around the globe, and as a result, there had been no summer that year, so Mary Shelley had stayed indoors and written her Frankenstein story. America had been more than reluctant to get involved in Hitler's war. And it wasn't that they hated war, so much as they thought that Hitler was right. And many had believed and hoped that Hitler was actually the Messiah. A majority of Americans were sympathetic about the Germans having, quote, just followed orders, close quote. So Germans escaping at the end of the war had found plenty of anonymous help towards that end. And Nazi scientists who didn't want to come to America were allowed into Syria and into Egypt, where they helped to build weapons to fight the Israelis. Christians at the time had seen the Holocaust as the inevitable unfolding of God's plan that was prophesied in the book of Revelation. And to get the chosen people back to the Holy Land, Jeremiah had written that God would first send the fishermen, and then he would send the hunters. Therefore, behold, the days come, said the Lord, that it shall no longer be said, the Lord lives, that caused the sons of Israel to come up out of the land of Egypt, but the Lord lives, that caused the sons of Israel to come up out of the land of the north wind, and from all the lands where he had driven them, and I will bring them again into their land, and that I gave unto their fathers. Behold, I send many fishers, saith the Lord, and they shall fish them. And after that I will send many hunters, and they shall hunt them from every mountain and from every hill and out of the holes of the rocks. Jeremiah 16:14-16, Jubilee Bible 2000. Were the Germans able to do the math in 1935, they would have understood what Einstein had discovered, that time is the fourth dimension and death the event horizon of time, the limit and impetus of being. And Speer blamed mere technology for the Nazis' rise to power, the loudspeaker, the radio, the telephone, and the telegram. And if that were true, what might advances in technology bring in the future, particularly towards a resurgence of Nazism? According to Heidegger, within the danger lies the rescue, so bring on the science. The Red Chinese would blame the radio for the Tiananmen Square riots in 1976 that were held in the spring just before Mao died. And in the Chinese language, the pictogram for democracy and mob were the same. And in 30 AD, the Jews hadn't been able to find anyone who could accuse Jesus convincingly before the high priests, so they had accused him as a mob. A Frenchman named Matthias Ringmann, helping a German mapmaker translate Latin names on an old Roman map, visited Italy in 1503, and there he'd heard plenty of Italians bragging about having discovered the New World. So Matthias Ringmann gave this New World the name of the Italian explorer Amerigo Vespucci. And that was how the German Waldseemüller came to use the name America for the first time on his map, and he created that map in 1507 by drawing the world on 12 wooden panels. And before that, America had just been labeled anonymous land. Waldseemüller had studied at the University of Freiburg, and he wanted to change the name from America after hearing criticism about the Italians getting credit for the discovery of America. But many hundreds of copies of the map had been printed and circulated and had been put into books, so the name was too well known by then to change, and Matthias lived only 3 more years after having given the name of America to the New World. The name America was 2 A's surrounding a nice French merci, thank you. And when the election of Donald Trump would remind many Jews of the rise of Hitler, they poured themselves into discrediting and impeaching him at all costs. Trump voters saw these efforts as a clear attempt to stamp out Christianity, which it was, and as the predominantly Jewish news media set about trying to destroy Trump's spirit of Elijah, American Christians discovered, to their relief and astonishment, the precise why of how the Holocaust had happened. Before that, it had been something of a mystery how such an evil thing could have come about. And as the Great Deception overcame Jews in the wake of the Holocaust, they assumed that Muslims should be given the protection Jews had been denied during Hitler's war, but they had it all backwards, and only the coming of Messiah could begin to straighten them out. The Nazis found out that it takes only 4 months to lose 1/4 of one's flesh, and in losing weight, nature makes people look beautiful so others will want to feed them. By the time Donald Trump was elected, the communist Chinese owned the American media, and their best attempts at brainwashing Americans into accepting communism was doomed to failure because there were just too many Scots in America, and Donald Trump was half Scottish himself. Trump's mother had been born in the Outer Hebrides of Scotland in 1912 on the 10th of May, and English had been her second language. And she told her son Donald that his father was Swedish, not German, in order to save him from the opprobrium dished out upon Germans after Hitler's war. Heidegger told us not to worry about being lumped into categories, nor to fear the best efforts of communists to force equality upon us, because the danger of sameness inequality was equally dissolved, easily dissolved by the uniqueness of each individual Dasein. If language is technology, and in the danger of technology resides the rescue, then the power of the written word should be able to save us, beginning with the simple discovery that the word alcoholic is an adjective, not a noun. If one has ingested toxins, one is toxic. And if one is full of vitriol, one is vitriolic. And if one is of German extraction, one is Germanic. So the source of denial lies in not being able to tell a difference from a similarity, that same sin found living in the heart of all technology. This discovery is found by sailing the river of understanding through the fourth dimension of time, and the intrinsic danger will continue until we realize that there is an addict within each and every one of us. The seven deadly sins make the world go around, instead of the world being flat. And the seven deadlies are those things ready to hand that may become addictions after a certain line gets crossed, beyond which there is no going back to normal life. Addiction is an adventuring beyond the horizon and a returning to a world that can no longer pretend to be what it once was. And recovery from addiction is either more difficult than any individual can bear, or one has not yet become an alcoholic. The only solution is to keep going, to explore that far horizon until one intimately knows its true nature, learns that addiction is across too far, a phenomenon of craving the human will is insufficient to remove. Addiction is purely a love of one or more of the deadly sevens, without which life has been rendered meaningless and empty until a sufficient substitute appears. Heidegger invented the concept of Dekehre, that in the German means a U-turn, and also connotes the action to sweep out. And in the transitive, Dekehre intends not just a turning around, but a transformation. Thus, a kehre is a turning away from drugs and alcohol, but only after having done them well enough. And remember that discussing salvation with someone who has alcohol in their system is like putting a paper sack over your head and screaming. The Big Book suggests waiting for a lucid interval on page 90, and even then, when questioning whether or not someone is alcoholic, the most perceptive among us can be convinced they aren't, and then, in the twinkle of an eye, hear them confess that they are alcoholic, temporarily or not. Any attempt to use symptoms in diagnosing alcoholism runs up against what Heidegger called mere appearance, or in the German, Krankheisterschen van Ugen. Krankheitserscheinungen. And 12-step programs are like black holes, because once you pass the event horizon, it's impossible to escape. People change when they get sober, and it happens when they sleep. Being alcoholic has such a strong spiritual component that German poetry can help. And the phrase in Hölderlin, schwellenden Augenbrauen, means swollen eyebrows or hangover, and stillen means quench. Der Weltvergessen means from the forgetting of the world. So both translations of the following poem can lead us down the exact same path. Schwellenden Augenbrauen, der Weltvergessen, Stolleuchtende Kraft aus heiliger Schrift fällt mirgen, der Gnade sich freuen sie am stillen Blicke sich üben. Schwellenden Augenbrauen, swollen eyebrows, and in the forgetting of this world, silent light falls in strength from sacred scriptures, then celebrant of that grace they may rehearse quiet vision. Hymns, translated by Emery E. George, page 255. An alternate translation says, as from the threshold of brows, oblivious to the world, they can exercise their silent gaze, rejoicing in grace. God wants to be appreciated at least half as much as an addict worships the object of their addiction. And grudging respect just isn't enough for him. So that's why God bestows special grace upon his alcoholic children. One must wonder why God loves humans and just what it is that is so precious to him about people. And the answer is obvious in the questioning, precisely in the effects of drugs and alcohol. Because Jesus had a real human body, He knew the effects of alcohol and of opium. And when we eat bread in remembrance that he had a body, both before and after his death, we share in the Catholic Mass. The question, however, is certainly irrelevant, which was debated at the time of the Reformation about the meaning of is, since neither the community nor Jesus himself had our concept of substance. People did not ask what a thing was, but what it was for, not in what it consisted, but what was its function. Paradoxically enough, the original Aramaic sentence was most probably formulated without even using the word with which the centuries-long controversy was concerned. In the original language, Jesus would have said, "This, my body," on Being a Christian, page 325. And then we ask, do we really want there to be a God? If we were able to solve the conundrum of alcoholism on our own, we wouldn't need God, and the actual phenomenon is that to stop an addiction is to kill one's God. The Big Book said that this was our dilemma. Who has anguish? Who has sorrow? Who has strife? Who is always fighting? Who is always complaining? Who has unnecessary bruises? Who has bloodshot eyes? It is the one who spends long hours in the taverns, trotting out new drinks. Don't gaze at the wine, seeing how red it is, how it sparkles in the cup, how smoothly it goes down, for in the end it bites like a poisonous snake, it stings like a viper. Proverbs 23:29, New Living Translation. Somebody said that Lucifer fought God because God was being too anonymous, too distant and ungodlike to fill the needs of mortals, according to Lucifer, who felt that humans needed an object of worship, so he had volunteered himself. The devil told Eve that doing drugs and alcohol would make her feel like God, and he was right. And when God gave man alcohol, he knew that humans would worship the supply and not the supplier. He's often perfectly sensible and well balanced concerning everything else, everything except liquor. He is often perfectly sensible and well balanced concerning everything except liquor, but in that respect he is incredibly dishonest and selfish. Alcoholics Anonymous, page 21. It's not about applying a spiritual solution to a problem of body and mind, but instead recognizing a spiritual sickness and coming to AA to get that disease made good. Specifically, when the spiritual malady is overcome, we straighten out mentally and physically. Alcoholics Anonymous, page 64. The people who strike it rich in AA are those who work the 12 steps the first time they see them, as quickly as they can be read. And the body of Christ is comprised of all those who accept, quote, the Spirit and the water and the blood, close quote. 1 John 5:8. Not just the Spirit, and not the Spirit encased in flesh, but the flesh and the blood and the mystery therein. Moshe of the Israel Bible Prophecy News Analysis and Ezekiel Temple Watch YouTube channel, who lives in the Galilee and speaks Hebrew, translated Daniel 9:24 as, 70 and 7 are set apart, and end of him that overflowing being decided, until the end of the war, ones being desolate, and has mastery covenant, to many ones 7, one akkad, half of 7, cease drinking, the drink offering, and on the wing of abomination, one making desolate, until finish, the one being decided, shall be poured forth on the one being made desolate. Is the one being decided the addict? Is being made desolate hitting bottom? Erectology said that an abomination is self-sickness. And Anon said that addiction is like getting one of those aliens attached to your face with a tentacle down your throat and another into your brain, and no matter how slowly you breathe, it hurts enough to make you cry while everyone hovers around wondering what to do, and a small voice in the back of your mind keeps telling you that living this way is so much better than life before the alien chose you. Everyone who saw Jesus knew he was the Messiah, and there had been no question about that. but they were all so bewildered about his drinking, and not a single one of them wanted a drunken Messiah. When God sends him back, Jesus will go right to AA, where everyone can look for him anonymously, lest word get out that the seeker had attended an AA meeting and might thereby, probably, have a drinking problem, after which all employers, neighbors, friends, and family members will look askance at that person who went to a meeting for the wrong reasons, because why else would you want to find him out, since the Holy Spirit is always available instead? With the growth of AA, people were willing to treat alcoholics as sick rather than as evil, because the nightmare of prohibition had been fresh in the minds of the big book writers. And this was a new approach, instead of just taking them out in the woods and shooting them, which was more the European method. The fun part about the Messiah returning anonymously to AA is that he'll probably be sent back drunk just to drive the point home, and a third of the planet will turn their back on him again. The German doesn't say goodbye, they say, "I'll see you again," and that meaning was preserved in the AA declarative, "Keep coming back." When anyone blames AA because they can't stay sober, that is making the Heidegger error, and holding one member of a group up as representative of the whole puts the whole world in danger. Heidegger had tried desperately to point this out to the Nazis, inviting them to sit in on his Nietzsche lectures, but merely blaming Jews had been the softer, easier way for the undereducated Nazis. Rather than doing the hard work of thinking, they'd come up with a false solution to a real problem, and the power of the group had metamorphosed from what Hitler had written. "The basis for all development is the creative urge of the individual, not the vote of majorities. The genius of the individual is decisive, not the spirit of the masses." Communism, Fascism, and Democracy, page 409. It had been the collectivist half of National Socialism that had turned voluntary sacrifices in the good of the state into a compulsory regimentation of the military, where individual generals in the army had become criminals for using their own judgment. When AA said, "Our common welfare must come first," they did not mean that the individual doesn't matter, but that the alcoholism we have in common must be the primary purpose of the group, lest we perish both as a group and separately in our own self-willed lives. When Americans were sent by court order to AA meetings, many wondered if the oversized photos of Bill W. and Dr. Bob hanging on the walls were perhaps from the Book of Revelation, the two witnesses that appear in the last days, or were they just the AA cult's leaders? Was this a fascist program?